Hello, I'm Bob Guerra.
And I'm Brittany Hodak.
Welcome to episode 11 of This Week in Country Music. It's Dolly Day in the studio. We're going to play an interview with the superstar in just a few minutes, and we'll hear all about her brand new soundtrack to the Netflix original film, Dumplin.
Dolly is absolutely, without a doubt, my favorite artist of all time. So I'm excited to play that interview. And as always, this week, we're going to have our favorite six songs in the Pick Six and Nashville's biggest news stories. And in terms of throwback interviews, what do you have for us this week, Bob?
What's better than more Dolly? Dolly is going to talk to us about her first impression of another superstar, Miss Loretta Lynn.
Awesome. Well, that sounds like fun. I can't wait to hear it. Let's jump right in with our six picks. I'm going to kick things off with a Christmas song because you told me I can play Christmas music this week.
I certainly did. I remember that.
Well, your buddy, Mitchell Tenpenny, is releasing his debut album, Telling All My Secrets, in about 2 weeks. But that didn't stop him from finding time to go into the studio to record a Christmas classic.
Speaking of secrets, Mitchell spilled a few for me this week in Nashville. I had a chance to interview him, and we're going to play that back in a future episode, hopefully next week. But for now, let's kick off our six with his rendition of the classic, Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas.
Here we are, as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends who are dear to us, gather near to us.
Let's roll right into another Christmas song. One of your favorites, I believe, Mr. Guerra.
Yes, Brett Eldredge.
Yeah, it's been 2 years since Brett originally put out his Christmas album, Glow, but it's become something of a holiday staple for fans who absolutely fell in love with the album and started bugging him for more songs, saying, why didn't you record this? Why didn't you record this? So this year, he re-released Glow and added seven new songs to it, including this one, Do You Hear What I Hear?
Do you hear what I hear? Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy. Do you hear what I hear? A song, high above the trees, with a voice as big as the sea. With a voice as big as the sea.
You know, Martina McBride has one of the best voices in country music history, and she is going to lend that voice to her brand new Christmas album, It's the Holiday Season. Martina loves Christmas classics, and she's got Frosty the Snowman and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer in this album.
You know, it's funny. With the first Christmas album that I made 20 years ago, I did a lot of hymns. You know, Come All Ye Faithful, What Child Is This, O Holy Night. And it was more orchestrated, more just a lot of strings. And with this album, wanting to take a little bit of a different tack, I took the big band swing route and had to find songs that really lended themselves to that kind of feel. So we ended up, I've always wanted to do Frosty the Snowman and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, but I always wondered, how can you do those songs in a way that's, you know, this fresh and different and not cheesy? So I think we pulled that off with these great arrangements.
Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say, Rudolph, with your nose so bright, won't you guide my sleigh tonight? Then how the reindeer loved him as he shouted out with glee, Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer, you'll go down in history.
What makes it interesting, Britt, is that she did the album in Hollywood with some of the best musicians of all time in the Capitol studio where Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr. recorded their albums, okay? And it's really kind of a throwback album to that sound, okay? It's bright, it's happy, and I think the fans are truly going to enjoy it.
Well, I saw her perform a few weeks ago when CMA recorded their Country Christmas special. It's going to air, I think, in about a week on ABC. But she was incredible. I mean, what a voice.
Yeah, I know. It's a big voice for a little lady.
Yeah. Speaking of little ladies with big voices, how great was the CMT special about Dumplin?
I really enjoyed every minute of it. She is such a superstar.
I always love when we get to kind of peek behind the scenes. I feel like a lot of times, you know, you just get to hear the songs. You don't get to see the artist in the studio. So I really thought it was fun just to see all of these artists being so excited to interact with such a legend and work with Dolly. So for anybody who didn't check it out, I think CMT is probably going to re-air it all month longer. I'm sure you can stream it. But it's the story of the making of Dumplin. And you get to see Dolly and producer Linda Perry with all kinds of artists, Macy Gray, Elle King, Alison Krauss. And this next one, Miranda Lambert, whose song is probably one of my favorites on the soundtrack. It's a remake of Dolly's classic Dumb Blonde.
Just because I'm blonde, don't think I'm dumb, 'cause this dumb blonde ain't nobody's fool. When you left, you thought I'd sit, and you thought I'd wait, and you thought I'd cry, and you called me a dumb blonde. Oh, but somehow I lived through it, and you know if there's one thing this blonde has learned, blondes have more fun.
One of the surprise stories of 2018 belongs to Russell Dickerson. This young fella has two number one songs back to back, Yours and Blue Tacoma. And this was done on an independent record label, which makes it even more amazing. It's a great story. And he's built a big fan base, that's for sure. The fans, as a matter of fact, are clamoring that he release this next song as his third single. It's called Every Little Thing. Here's Russell.
'Cause I love
love how intertwined his story is with Carly Pierce's story. I mean, they've been friends for years. They played shows together way back in the day, which actually inspired the name of their tour that kicks off next month, the Way Back Tour. And they both had songs called Every Little Thing on their album. I believe we have one song left, and I wasn't keeping track, but I think I get one more Christmas song.
You got more than was allowed, but let's just roll with it. I'm in a festive mood, Britt.
All right, perfect. Well, this is, I think, one of the best Christmas albums that came out this year, and certainly one that fans were waiting for probably the longest, Aaron Watson. Aaron said in an interview that he basically recorded this album because he was tired of getting harassed by fans, that he couldn't play shows in November or December without people saying, put out a Christmas record. So he did. And it's awesome. His wife and even his kids sing on several of the songs.
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. And, you know, I think all of his fans agree it was worth the wait.
I guess there's 10 songs on it, two originals, right? And knowing you, I bet you're going to pick one of the originals.
Guilty. I mean, I do love the covers. It's great. There's some really good classics on it. But I just love, love, love the song that I chose. It's a song all about Mary's awe after giving birth. I think every mom will be able to relate to the song. It was just, you know, such a great idea to write a song about that moment and Mary's feelings and perspective. So I hope you like it. Here's Aaron Watson with She Stared at Him All Night.
She sang fa la 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 la, fa la 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 la, hark the herald angels sing. She sang fa la 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 la, fa la 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 la, you are the King of Kings. And she stared at him all night, she stared at him all night, she stared at him all silent, holy night.
All right, now, as always, you can hear this week's six songs in their entirety by searching for the This Week in Country Music playlist wherever you stream.
Okay, I guess it's time to play back our Dolly interview. Britt and I decided to do this one together, And we found where Dolly was and took our little recorder and sat down with her. And what I thought was cool is when she walks in the room, it's like the whole room lights up. It's like Annie Mame. I mean, she just comes in and just she just oozes with this magnetism, doesn't she?
Absolutely. She's just incredible. So here's Dolly.
What helped you decide to lend your voice and support to this motion picture for Netflix that's coming out called Dumplin?
Well, how could I not? Because there was a book that came out. The book was called Dumplin, and this was on the New York Times bestseller list a few years ago. And I had several people call and tell me that there was a book out that had me in it, that I was the inspiration for this little character in the book, that she loved my music and my sayings. And I was just real flattered and real honored, and I thought no more about it. A couple of years later, I get a call from Jennifer Aniston, who adapted that book, and now she's put it into a movie. She's also starring in it. And they had called to ask if they could license my music, a lot of my original music for the movie, and I said, well, sure. And then they asked if I would write some original stuff, and I did. I thought, well, that's the least I could do since it's kind of based on someone liking my music. So that's how it all started.
Are you in it?
I'm not in it. No, they asked me to be in it, and they asked me if I wanted to be a producer. I said, no, I couldn't do that because it would be too self-serving, because the show is about me, and I thought, well, it's about my music, so I figured I could honestly write and be involved in the music without it looking like I thought, oh yeah, Lola Parton's really great. You know, it would have felt funny to me. So I was not willing to be involved in any way other than the music, and that was why the little girl loved me anyway. And so it just seemed natural, and I thought, well, who else? They can't ask somebody else to do the music. I have to do it. If there's additional music, wouldn't be right for somebody else to come in and do it.
Well, and the album's incredible. You worked with Linda Perry on it. What I want to know, with such a huge catalog, how did you decide which of the songs from your career to use, and how did those all come together?
Well, I didn't decide those things. Actually, the only decisions that I made for it was to write the additional new songs. There's six new songs, and Linda and I wrote five of them together. And then I wrote one that I sang with Mavis Staples. I did that one along. But the rest, they actually wanted to know if they could use them. And then they're the ones that asked to do it. Linda and the people, the production people with I guess, Jennifer Aniston's company, you know, her production company. So I just went where I was told. I didn't feel like I should get any more involved than what they wanted me to do on the music. So I didn't try to push anything. I didn't suggest anything. I just said, I'll do whatever you want me to do. And that's how it all came to be.
You worked with Sia on the single that's out now, with Elle King, with Miranda Lambert, so many amazing females. Was that a conscious decision of those duets? Or
that was
did they
my
bring some
decision.
Of those to you as well?
I actually think that Linda Perry had a lot to do with a lot of those artists. I know that that the director of the movie, and I think she had some connections with some of these people, and I know that that Linda had some input. But they brought, I don't know who found the old songs, a couple of the songs. The one I did with Elle King was from one of my early albums in the Porter Wagoner days.
Really?
The one I did with Sia was a song that I had done, wrote in the 60s, and it was on one of my early albums as well, at the Here I Am. And so then we had and Two Doors Down with Macy Gray. I wrote a new one I was mentioning called I Wonder Why, and had Mavis sing on that one. But they just, they just picked the songs, and I said, and they picked the girls, and Miranda Lambert. I love her, but I didn't ask for one of them. Mm. And now I did too. That's a lie. I asked for Rhonda Vincent and Alison Krauss because I love them. They're my friends, and they're bluegrass. I thought, I can't have all these other women from all these other places and not get my own girls on here singing, because we did one that was real country flavored. Linda had produced it, and it sounded like a Johnny Cash, June Carter track. And I thought, well, we got to have Rhonda and Allison on that, because Rhonda Vincent is the top girl in bluegrass, and so is Allison. So I thought, well, I got to have them, because they're also my buddies. We sing for each other different times through the years.
You mentioned writing a song for this soundtrack. Do you still write a lot? I mean, I know in the past it said you you walk around the kitchen and basically are coming up with songs. Do you just keep it going and write constantly?
It keeps itself going. I have little to do with that. I mean, there's always some music going on in my head. And I have the gift of rhyme, so everything's a rhyme. I look at something, if I look at dime, I think of time. I look at, you know, rhyme, I think of time. But I mean, I just am able to do that. But I really am touched by things. I'll be watching TV, somebody will say something, it'll inspire an idea and think, oh, that would make a really good idea for a song. Or that I'm just influenced by living and life. And
do you jot them down as they go on?
I do, because I have to or I'll forget them, especially this day and time. I'm older now. I can't even remember my name at the time. But, yeah, I try to keep a notepad close by. And I always keep I used to keep a little dictaphone, you know, around, and, you know, whether it's, you know, I've always got something where I don't want to lose a melody. I'll stop what I'm doing and get the flour off my hands if I'm cooking. If I really come up with a great melody, I think, oh, I got to get the guitar. I got to see if this works as much, as good in my hands as it does in my head. And then I'll put down a piece of that just so I don't lose the melody. Then I'll go back to my cooking. Then I can write even with dough on my hands. You know, I can go scribble something down. But anyway, that's just how I do it. It's just a living thing with me. It's a way of life. I don't even think about it. Music is just part of me.
You're one of the greatest female stars in the history of country music and pop music, as far as I'm concerned. What are your thoughts about the lack of women in terms of radio, on the radio these days?
Well, I think there's, you know, we can't ever get enough women in anything. We'll tell you that, right?
Absolutely.
Even if we overdo it sometimes. But anyway, I really think that that is changing, and I think that will change, because people are, I really don't think anybody's trying to keep the women down in that. I really don't, because I think, I know record labels, they want to make money. They don't care what you are. They don't care if you're green or blue or black or white or pop or rock, boy or girl. If they think they can make some money, they're going to record you. And hopefully, now that, you know, we have been standing up more for ourselves and a lot of good things have been happening, maybe now it'll be more of a natural, easier flow that job's been done, kind of like it did when we first did 9 to 5, the movie. You know, we touched on those subjects of, you know, harassment in the workplace, equal pay, equal rights, and all that. And there was a lot of improvement for a long time after that. Well, we still have the same problems, but we're doing another 9 to 5 sequel. It's still addressing the same things.
Really?
So things just, you know, I think things will progress. Every little change changes something else, and hopefully to the better. So I'm just out there living my life and hope to be a good example, writing my songs and hope I say the right things. I don't have to feel like I have to stand in the streets and preach it or anything, but I would if I felt I had to. But I just feel like that I, you know, you need to live an example and be an example. And I try to be that.
Well, and let me just say, for all the women in the world, you absolutely are. Not just for music, but philanthropy and business. You are such an amazing role model and such a just fantastic person. So if anybody out there is looking for a mold, you're certainly the one.
Well, thank you. I am a little molded. I'm old right now.
Well, with all the success that you've had in music and movies, I wonder if you've given any thought to a real, true biopic. With the success of the Queen movie and the excitement with the Elton one coming, surely you've thought about this. Can you give us any
clues? Have thought about it, and the only reason I haven't done it so far is I'm trying to figure out whether to do it as a musical like La La Land, or whether to do it like a, you know, like Loretta Lynn's Coal Miner's Daughter, Coat of Many Colors type thing. And I'm definitely putting it on stage as a musical. So yes, I have put a lot of thought into it, been working on it for years, and so we're about ready to do that type of thing.
Amazing. Well, I can't wait to see Dumplin. Thank you for all of the work that you've done. And on a personal note, I just wanted to thank you for all the work you do with your Imagination Library. You have a million kids every single month who are excited to go to the mailbox and get a book from the book lady, Aunt Dolly, my son being one of them. So congratulations on passing the 100 millionth book milestone and having that as part of your incredible legacy.
Well, thank you. I'm probably as proud of that as anything I'll ever do. And so it's a wonderful program. I have a lot of wonderful people helping. So it's my philosophy that you can't get too many books in the hands of enough children. So anyway, we're continuing with all that. And thank you for stopping by and letting me be part of your new show. Hope you do well.
Well, you know, Dolly, I just, in closing here, just want to thank you for what you've done for us in the industry and continue to do. It's not like you've all of a sudden decided to go sit in your big house someplace and play your old records. You're basically.
No, I don't even play my records. I'm not even a fan of mine as a singer. I always pick it apart because I think, oh, I wish I'd have done this. I wish I'd have done that. I wish I hadn't sung it that way.
No, you got to see it. You got to see it from the other side. I just admire you so much for the fact that you're always thinking ahead. You never slow down for a second, and you're a model for everybody, not just women of the world. So, congratulations to you. We're going to be watching this Netflix movie.
And everybody can watch the movie on December 7th on Netflix.
Yeah, I'm excited to see it myself. I want to see how it all looks and seeing it when everybody else is watching it at the same time.
Well, thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you.
She really is one of a kind.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, whether you're 1 or 101, Dolly's got something for you. If you have kids in your life and you don't know about Dolly's Imagination Library, you need to check it out. It's so incredible. All you do is sign up online and a free book shows up in your mailbox every single month until your kid's 5th birthday.
Wait a minute. Every month and it's free?
Yep, it's totally free. Like we said in the interview, she's distributed over 100 million books for free just to inspire the love of reading in children. And, you know, it's so great. My son and all of his cousins, they're so excited when these books arrive because, you know, you think about it, kids don't get a lot in the mail. So when something came to them that's theirs, you know, their faces light up and it's just so incredible. And the fact that, you know, Dolly's still sending out over a million books every single month to kids all over the US and UK and Australia, so amazing.
You know, it's just another layer of her amazing legacy. And at 72, she's not showing any signs of slowing down anytime soon. I got a kick out of the interview when you asked her about the doing a biography of her in a movie. And I was like, we were presenting it like, you've been giving any thought to this? She says, I've been thinking about this for the last 5 years. She's ahead of us. Other than the Dumplin soundtrack getting released, what other big news do we have this week, Britt?
Well, you know, I always like to start by giving props to the chart toppers. CMA's Best New Artist winner, Luke Combs, is back on top of the Billboard Country Albums chart, probably thanks in part to that awesome recognition from the CMA.
Yeah.
His platinum-selling debut, This One's For You, is on top of that chart it feels like it's like the 30th week now that he's been up there with that. So hats off to Luke. Dan and Shay on top of the Hot Country Songs chart. Their hit Speechless. They're also holding down the number 3 spot on that chart with Tequila. So good job, those guys. And finally, over at Country Radio, Jimmy Allen's on top for a second week in a row with Best Shot. Here's something fun I saw. Fitness guru Tim McGraw announced he's opening a number of boutique gyms across the country. The first one is going to open here in Nashville in January. It's a partnership with Snap Fitness, and it's called TrueMav. So all you New Year's resolutioners can look forward to that one.
What does TrueMav mean? Do you have any idea?
I don't. I actually was trying to find him talking about it. I'm not sure what the inspiration was for the name. But, I mean, if I could go somewhere and get as ripped as Tim McGraw, it doesn't matter what it's called. Like, I just, whatever program he's on, I feel like it's not going to work for me because I feel like, you know, he probably doesn't drink 3 Dr. Peppers a day and eat chocolate for breakfast. So it's like not a diet I could get on board with. But
maybe it means true maverick.
Maybe.
Well, I'll check it out this week. I got to know what true mav means. So,
yeah. All right. So next up, the Grand Ole Opry, obviously an institution. They have built a legacy for almost a century now of exposing all levels of country artists, not just superstars and legends, but rising talent as well. And they've come up with a program called Opry Next Stage to really help launch and propel new talent that they believe in. So they're taking developing artists saying, we believe in you. We're going to put you into, you know, all these cool content programs. We're going to give you a platform. We're going to let you play on the Opry stage. So their inaugural class includes Riley Green, Tegan Marie, Tennille Towns, and Travis Denning. So congrats to all of those guys.
That's an awesome idea. I mean, you know, a few years ago, they actually started the program in a different way by just introducing young people who had not had hit records on the Opry. And the first one I can remember is Josh Turner. Nobody had heard of Josh when he came and was performing on the Opry and sang Long Black Train. And, you know, they were giving him standing O's, and his career took off from there. So it's these youngsters that you mentioned here, they could be tomorrow's superstars.
Yeah, what a great story about Josh. And it really goes to show, you know, the reverence and the love that these artists have for the Opry already. You know, it's already such a huge honor when an artist plays the Opry for the first time. So I just love that they found a way to make their story even more intertwined with these artists that are on the rise. All right, one last thing. You know, I'm a sucker for country music history.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm always trying to figure out, like, what happened today, 10 years ago or 15 years ago or 30 years ago. Not even just for the show, just like in everyday life, I like to know. And you are never going to guess whose debut album came out 20 years ago. It blew my mind. November 30th, 1998. Guess who put out their first record?
1998. With Shania, maybe?
Perhaps. But on this day in particular in 1998, it was actually Granger Smith.
What?
Right? Isn't that crazy?
That's nutty.
It's totally nuts. I had no idea. I knew he'd been putting out music for a long time, but 20 years? I mean, he barely looks 20 years old.
I would have never guessed that.
Yeah, well, his first self-released album called Waiting on Forever came out 2 decades ago.
Wow.
And, you know, today he's got another release coming out, his self-produced documentary film, They Were There, which is absolutely incredible. So touching. It tells the story of several soldiers. You can find it on YouTube. You can also hear the accompanying soundtrack called They Were There that Granger put together for the film.
Okay. It's time now for our legacy segment. And I've always thought it would be interesting to hear what one superstar thought about another future superstar the first time they ever heard them. And so our guest, Dolly Parton, is going to talk to us about the first time she ever heard of Loretta Lynn.
Well, the first time I heard of Loretta, I just remember everybody talking about this country girl. And especially at home, everybody was saying, she's just like us. She's just like us, Lord. She's just like Aunt So-and-so, or she's just like so-and-so. And they said, she'll get up on stage and she just takes her shoes off. She goes out on stage with rollers in her hair. I mean, she's just like a real person. So I started hearing the songs and I thought, well, now that is just something for somebody to write songs like Don't Come Home and Drinking.
I love when we get to hear your throwbacks. You said that was what, from 1994?
Yeah, it was. And it was from a radio special that was done with Tammy Wynette, Dolly, and Loretta Lynn. They had an album out at that time called Honky Tonk Angels. Remember now, you can check out our playlist, This Week in Country Music, on your favorite streaming sites, and then follow me on Instagram at Bob Guerra, G-U-E-R-R-A, Nashville, and then follow the show at This Week in Country. I'm Bob Guerra.
And I'm Brittany Hodak. Be sure to send us all of your favorite Christmas songs because we're putting together our favorites for the year. We'll have a Christmas episode coming up. We'll also have a year in review New Year's show. So don't just follow us. Tell us what you like and what you want to hear more of.
You know what? They can also send us some of their favorite songs from 2018 and we can try to include that in our final show for the year.
Yeah, that's a great idea. Send them our way. Thanks for listening to This Week in Country Music.